Well, good evening, everyone. We want to welcome you to the International Chapel of Vienna's Christmas Eve service. And before we begin to have our Christmas readings, I'd like to open up in a word of prayer. And then afterwards, we'll be hearing from different ones in our church who will be reading for the Christmas message. And then following that, we'll be hearing a message from Rob Schaefer. So let's open up with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you that on this evening, we can celebrate your coming. Lord, again, that this hope that we have in you is real and true. We talked about the joy we have in you, the faith we have in you, the life we have in you. Lord God, tonight we're going to talk about the love that we have in you. So Father, I pray you bless this message, bless the reading to everyone who's listening. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's a little one, Tommy. That's, and then to the big one. Please, melt.
And today we have the privilege of lighting the Christ candle with you, because today is the day that we celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. The first passage we're reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 16 and 18.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
The second passage we're reading is from the letter of John, the first letter of John, chapter 4, verses 9 and 11. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. And the final verse is from Psalms 24, 7-10. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. Amen.
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 Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
The end.
The end.
I'll be reading the first lesson for today, and the title is Rebellion, Curse, and Hope. I'll be reading from Genesis chapter 3, verse 14 to 19. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I'll put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. To the woman, he said, I'll make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor, you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. To Adam, he said, because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return. Amen.
This is the second lesson, The Seed of Abraham, from Genesis 22:15-18. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand in the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed, because you have obeyed me.
This next scripture passage is about Christ's birth foretold. I'll be reading from Isaiah 7:14 and then Isaiah 9:2 and 6 and 7. Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
His heritage and his birthplace.
In Psalm 89, verses 3 and 4, the Lord says, I have made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn unto David, my servant. Your seed will I establish forever and build up your throne to all generations.
Isaiah 11, 1 through 2 says, There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord.
Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 5 and 6. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will dwell securely. And this is the name by which he will be called, The Lord is our righteousness.
Micah chapter 5, verse 2. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days.
I'm reading from Matthew chapter 1, 18 to 23.
And this is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to her, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what she has conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you will give him the name Jesus, because he will save many people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son. They will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hands? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels stroll? When you kiss your little baby, then you kiss the face of
lesson of the birth of Jesus. I'm reading from Luke chapter 2, verse 1 to 7. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, and to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
This is the seventh lesson, the proclamation of the shepherds. The passage is in Luke chapter 2, verse 8 to 20. And they were in the same country, shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over the flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were so afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherd returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them.
O holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long live the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices, oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born, oh, night divine, oh, night divine. Led by the light of faith, the serenely beaming, with glowing hearts, by his cradle we stand. So led by the light of a star sweetly gleaming, here come the wise men from Orient land. The King of Kings lay thus in lowly manger, in all our trials, born to be our friend. He knows our need. To a weakness, no stranger, behold our King before him lowly bend. Behold your King before him lowly bend. Truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, for let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is our Lord, then ever, ever. proclaim his power and glory evermore. Proclaim.
Good evening. The year 2020 will be remembered surely as the year of COVID-19. It has been a painful, disastrous, lonely year for many people. What started out as an unknown disease of some kind that was far, far away, soon spread to touch everyone in ways big and small. In the next few minutes, I would like us to consider, by way of a limited analogy, some similarities and differences between a virus and its vaccine and sin and its redemption. First, a similarity. Some people, even some governments, have denied or minimized the existence or the power of the virus. They see it as a hoax, a conspiracy to frighten us, to make us give up some of our freedoms. They have the attitude, no one is going to tell me what to do with my life. Some people say that sin is also a hoax, a threat used by churches to control people, to tell them what they should and shouldn't do. These people say, you talk of a God and we've never seen him. Science has proven that we don't need God, just ourselves. We have the power within ourselves to make ourselves and this world a better place. No one is going to tell me how to live my life. Another similarity between the COVID virus and sin, we need someone else to provide the remedy of a vaccine. Major international pharmaceutical companies across the world are working hard. They're spending money, doing research, testing their product, all in the effort to find a cure. The Bible also teaches us that we cannot save ourselves from sin and its consequences. No matter how hard we try to do the right thing to please God, we cannot bridge the gap that separates us as sinful people from a holy God. The Bible says that we are totally dependent on someone else to provide the vaccine, the remedy for our condition. Now, here are some differences in this analogy. First, science cannot guarantee success in finding a vaccine or a cure for COVID-19. We will have to be satisfied, even grateful, for a product that is 85 or 90 or maybe 95% successful. No one is promising or guaranteeing absolute 100% protection from the current virus, much less from mutations that may occur in the future. It is a work in progress and may never be completed. However, the Bible tells us that God says we can be sure of a 100% remedy for our sinful condition. He has promised a 100% guarantee because he is the one providing the remedy, the vaccine, if you will, in his Son, Jesus Christ, the second person of the Godhead, who is God Emmanuel, God with us. Conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead, conquering death for us and destroying the power of Satan. Another difference in our categories is this. The COVID virus comes from outside us. It started its journey last year
and was spread worldwide as people came in contact with other people who had it. It comes from the outside and enters into our body where it does its damage, sometimes resulting even in death. By contrast, the virus of sin is within us. We are born in a state of separation from God. This condition has existed ever since the rebellion of the first man and woman, Adam and Eve. Every person who is born after Adam and Eve is born with a sin nature, a tendency to sin. Someone said, "We are not sinners because we sin. We sin because we are sinners." Here's what Jesus said about humankind's condition in the Gospel of Mark in chapter 7. Jesus said, "What comes out of a person is what defiles him. For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." Here's another difference in our examination of a virus and sin. Science may in time provide a remedy, a vaccine that will prove to be effective for many people for a period of time. Until another virus comes along or COVID-19 mutates. And science will probably never produce one that produce a vaccine that has a 100% guarantee. But science is totally concerned with this world and the physical and psychological diseases of this world. In fact, some scientists would say science does not address or have the ability to address mankind's inner moral condition. In fact, some scientists would say that there is no moral condition to address. They say that people exist by chance, there is no real purpose to living, and when we die, our existence ends. However, the Bible teaches that mankind is both body and spirit, that we are made in the image of God, and that that image has been greatly distorted by sin. We are moral beings with a sense of right and wrong, good and evil. And we know that we cannot change our moral condition by ourselves, by just trying harder. Therefore, we can never be good enough to be in God's holy presence. And that is just why we need the vaccine that only God can provide. Jesus said this about himself in the Gospel of Mark again in chapter 10. "For even the Son of Man," Jesus is talking about himself, "did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom, a penalty for many." In John's Gospel, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." This is why we celebrate the birth of Jesus tonight. He came into this world to save us from a virus that is in all of us, and from which we cannot find a remedy by our own strength or wisdom. This Advent, churches everywhere have lit 4 candles representing hope, peace, joy, and love. Tonight we lit the Christ candle as a symbol and recognition that he has come, Jesus the Messiah. God is with us. He is the world's only cure, the vaccine, if you will, for the virus that is in us all. God has promised us his peace in this world, regardless of our external circumstances. And more importantly, he has promised that one day he will return to take home with himself all those who have accepted his planned remedy, his vaccine, if you will, for our virus, our sinful condition. Tonight, I invite you, I encourage you to think about these truths and the gracious invitation and solution that God has offered to us by sending his son Jesus into this world and whose birth we joyfully celebrate. Those who have trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior from sin have received forgiveness and have been reconciled to God. They have a new relationship, an open relationship with God. We have moved from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his glorious light. In the midst of the darkness that surrounds us, even the darkness that COVID spreads, we can experience the peace of Christ. Jesus said to his followers, "Peace I give you, not as the world gives. In this world you will have troubles, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world." In Philippians 4, Paul writes of a peace that is beyond all comprehension, a peace that is not based on the circumstances that surround us, but on the solid foundation of our faith in Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. May we look to him this Christmas and every day in the new year as the true source of our peace, our hope, our vaccine. Amen.
Well, we want to thank Rob for that message. And yes, it's so true that for the cure for sin, it really is. It comes from the Son of God himself. And so I want to close with this prayer of benediction and blessing upon the body of Christ. And it's from Romans 15, verse 13. And it says, "Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." Let's pray. Father, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, by sending your Son to pay for sin. God, you are the cure for this world. You are what we are looking for. In you, Lord God, we find our hope. In you, we find our joy, our faith, and our peace. And most of all, Lord, we find in you our love. And so, Father, I pray for your hand of blessing upon every family for Christmas, every home, every individual, those traveling. And Father, I pray specifically for those who are feeling sick, who are not feeling well. Father, we pray for your hand of healing and strengthening during this season. And in everything, Lord God, I pray that we are able to express your amazing, boundless love to one another. In Jesus' name, amen.